So let me start with a welcome, especially to those who might be visiting the campus today. Welcome to the University of Michigan at Dearborn and to this fantastic event, which has been in planning for quite some time. So let me start by introducing myself. I'm Professor Scott DiGregorio, Associate Professor in the Honors Program. The sponsors of this event have been very gracious with their support, in particular the College of Arts, Sciences, and Letters, the Department of Literature, Philosophy, and the Arts, and the Campus Honors Program. So without their gracious funding, we wouldn't be here today. So thank you very much. 3 years ago, in November of 2013, the campus hosted a similar event. It was a roundtable discussion on the historical Jesus, and it was entitled The Historical Jesus, Four Views. The four views being Jesus as understood from a Jewish perspective, from a Christian perspective, from an Islamic perspective, and yes, even a mythicist perspective. That event is on YouTube. The whole event was filmed, as this one is being filmed, and so you can Google it and chase it up and watch it there if you happen to miss it. Since then, my colleague and co-organizer for today's panel, Dr. Imran Ajiz, Associate Professor of Philosophy, we've had more than sort of one lively conversation about that event, and in particular about the challenges that the two of us face in teaching sacred texts to students, and in particular questions of history in this connection with sacred literature, in particular of Christianity and Islam. And here I don't mean the great doctrines of these religions, since that lies well outside the remit of a public institution like the University of Michigan-Dearborn, but rather questions of a historical nature. Was there really an exodus from Egypt? Was Jesus really born in Bethlehem? Did Muhammad really go to Medina, and so on and so forth? Is there a way to know what counts as evidence in such matters, and what are the best methods for attacking questions like this? So discussing questions like these with students is fascinating, not least because such discussions belong to a much wider framework of investigation that taps into a very large and vibrant scholarly field of study here. And professional scholarship itself, which has been going on at least since the 19th century, if not sooner, and continues with great energy today. And scholars here are often divided into two camps that you might call maximalists and minimalists. Maximalists holding that, say, the biblical story is more or less correct, unless it can be proven otherwise by archaeology, and minimalists who would say that the biblical story must be read as fiction, unless it can be confirmed archaeologically. And to be sure here, this really isn't a divide between, say, atheists and believers, but rather a debate among scholars about whether sufficient evidence really exists to warrant claims about historicity. So we thought it would be a good idea to move this discussion from the classroom from serendipitous meetings in the hallway and the coffee room and the mail room and so on, and to bring it to a bigger venue and invite some experts in the field to come and to have this discussion with us today. And so that's how the idea for this panel came about. And so let me now introduce our three speakers who will be speaking in this order. First on Judaism is Dr. Michael Pitlick, who's Director of Judaic Studies at Oakland University, where he teaches a wide range of courses on ancient Israel and Judaism. He holds degrees from Asparitus University and is a frequent traveler to Israel, where he's participated frequently in several archaeological excavations, and we'll be speaking today, I think, on exactly that topic. We'll then hear next on Christian Christianity from Dr. Robert M. Price, who was actually a participant in that roundtable in 2013, so welcome back. A former Baptist minister and a fellow of the Jesus Seminar, Dr. Price holds doctorates in theology and New Testament from Drew University and is an author of a great many books, including Deconstructing Jesus, 2000, The Reason-Driven Life, Why Am I Here on Earth For, 2006, The Christ Myth Theory and Its Problems, written in 2011, Killing History, Jesus in the No-Spin Zone in 2014, and most recently, and bearing very much on this topic, Moses and Minimalism, Form, Criticism versus Fiction in the Pentateuch, which was published in 2015. Finally, we'll hear from Dr. Herbert Berg, Professor of International Studies at the University of North Carolina, Wilmington, where he teaches courses on Islam and various other religious traditions. Dr. Berg did his PhD at the University of Toronto, good school, that's where I got my PhD as well. And he has also authored several books, including The Development of Exegesis in Early Islam, The Debate Over the Authenticity of Muslim Literature from the Formative Period, published in 2000, Elijah Muhammad and Islam, published in 2009, and then a second book entitled Elijah Muhammad, published in 2013. So finally, let me just say a word on the format. These speakers will go in this order. We'll hear from Dr. Picklick first, then Dr. Price, and then Dr. Berg. Each will speak for about 15 to 20 minutes. We'll then have a sort of a 10-minute roundtable where they can dialogue amongst themselves. And then we will open the floor for questions. Okay, so without further ado, Dr. Pitlick.
All right, thank you. So the biggest challenge here is 20 minutes, of course. Welcome, everybody. Thank you very much for coming. I would like to talk today a little bit about this particular site that I was fortunate enough to be involved with for five seasons with Hebrew University. We took students from Oakland University there for five seasons, and then we moved on to another site, which we're excavating now, but for the last three seasons. And I'll show you a little bit about what we have found from this particular site. And as far as myself, I guess, put it out there, I'm sometimes a maximalist when it fits, when the evidence fits, and sometimes I'm a minimalist when it doesn't fit. So I'm not sure that those terms are always helpful. We tend to group people into certain areas, and it's not always helpful, but let's just see what we have found. Okay.
Cell phones.
All right, let's talk about what we know about the historical periods and what we think we know about the historical periods. This is pertaining to the biblical tradition primarily, and also these ages are associated with not only settlement patterns and geopolitical concerns, but they also sort of more or less line up with a sense in the Bible as well, loosely. We're talking about roughly one main period here, but before that, we have the Iron Age I period, which is just 200 short years. And in that particular period, we're looking here at one reference that we have there on the early side, and that is this one from about 1206 BC. Israel is mentioned for the first time on an Egyptian text. This is not a biblical text, obviously. This is the first time Israel is mentioned. This is the famous Merneptah Stele. And Israel as a people is mentioned there. This gives us a sort of an anchor in the beginning part of this. Who are these people, Israel, though? They don't tell us that. The Bible fills in some things already. If we had to equate this particular period with a biblical tradition, it would more or less fall under the book, say, of Judges. The book of Judges in the Tanakh is a book that talks about how the Israelites organize themselves, their march towards a monarchy, which eventually leads us to about this period down here at the end, where during this period we see the formative stage archaeologically of a new people. This is a difficult thing to find in archaeology. Ethnicity is not something archaeologists are often able to find. It's a tricky subject. It's a tricky way to deal with the facts. But this particular period here, as far as the organization of the people in a particular portion of Canaan, ancient Canaan, the central hill country, is where we think is the incubator of the Israelites. When we get down to this period here, we start to move towards the magical number of 1,000, which is convenient for us, but we have to take that sort of tentatively now based on what we have found in archaeology. The biblical tradition lines up right around 1000 BC to say, at least in Judah, maybe parts of the ancient kingdom of Israel as well, that there was a process towards a kingdom. Small one, not exactly the way the Bible describes it as being far-flung under David. Of course, we're talking about David. That's the way he looked back in his day, by the way. But I want to call your attention here to something that's very important, because a minimalist writ large would often say that the biblical texts are not reliable. They're too late. They're written down much later than the processes and the periods they describe. So we can't take them at face value. And that isn't such a bad thing, actually. But here is something that we can't argue. Or yes, we can always argue everything. But the extra biblical source, meaning outside the Bible, comes from this reference from Egypt. Now, there's a number of ways to look at this, but more or less scholars agree that here we have the first reference to Israel at about 1206 BC. Okay? Israel, according to this king, is laid waste. Now, it's referenced here as a people, not a country or anything like this. This is before the country. But as a people, they're saying that this particular Egyptian king claims that he eradicated this group, which is clearly not true. So even here, we have to look at the text carefully. Okay? Now, what happened in the next period? The period here in the shaded green is where we focus in on a specific portion of the Iron Age II. Now, these ages that we apply to archaeology have to do usually with social processes, cultural processes, etc. But what does that mean? Iron Age II is supposed to correlate with the formation of a kingdom. So the biblical tradition associates with these first kings, Saul, David, and Solomon. They all lived one next to each other, and in case of David and Solomon, Solomon is David's son. So this is a period in the first, say, 30 to 40 years of the formation of the tribes, formation of the kingdom in Judah. We have what is the Bible calls the United Monarchy. Now this can be a little problematic too, because it doesn't appear that this, from archaeology, this is the way it all happened. You don't have a kingdom that explodes overnight. In 1000 BC, David didn't wake up and have a full-blown kingdom. This takes time. Archaeologically, we can see that it does take time for this to happen. So here we have the Iron Age II in archaeology, at least the archaeology of Israel. We're pointing to the period when we start to see the process towards a state. Now, there's certain things that come with a state that archaeology is better than the biblical text at trying to find out. Is there a capital? Is there a defense structure? Are there processes like roads and infrastructure and administration, taxation, all the various things that go with the kingdom of practically any size. And for the first time in, say, the last 15 years or so, and especially in the last 10 years, we're able to see this process a little more clearly. And it's not just from Jerusalem, which is a very difficult place to excavate for a number of reasons. Okay, so Solomon we're not going to worry about, but we're going to try to correlate a little bit here with what the Bible claims is going on, and see what actual evidence we have. Okay. Another very important anchor is this one. This broken piece of stone is called the Tel Dan Stele, the other anchor. It was found over two seasons, 93 and 94. And this particular inscription was found in the northern part of Israel. It's 150 or so years after David supposedly lived at 1000 BC. But in about 835 BC, King Hazael of Damascus boasts that he defeated a number of Israelite kings from the house of David. Now, the house here refers to the dynasty this king is reporting occurred established 150 years earlier. Again, it's outside the Bible. For a minimalist, this should be good news, right? You see why? It's outside the Bible. It's an objective sort of thing. And like we had the early anchor over here, we have Israel somewhere in the middle here. We have processes that lead to down the road after David, Solomon, and his sons, etc. We have the house of David, someone else is referring to. This is a big piece of data. Now, a number of people claimed in the beginning this was a forgery. That was dismissed. Then it says something else. That was dismissed. Again, more or less, and not everybody will agree on everything, clearly in archaeology. You have this anchor over here, and then you have the house of David. So what happened in between? That's the tricky part. Who did it? Did David actually live? Is this a myth, or how does this all work? So these are the important things. I just want to show you just a briefly sort of the evolution quickly of archaeology in what is now Israel or Canaan, Palestine. This is the early mission statement from 1870 of an association known as the Palestine Exploration Society. You can see what they're after here. This is more or less what for 2,000 years, even maybe even more prior to that, the Bible was taken at face value. Okay, so they said here, the importance of our work here is that modern skepticism assails the Bible at the point of reality, the question of fact. Whatever goes to verify the Bible in history as a real in time and place is a refutation of unbelief. Now, this is the mission statement for an archaeological society. That's where we start. Okay? Now, there's a lot of reaction to this. Mid-1800s is a very informative period because we have a lot of things going on in discoveries in geology, archaeology, philology, all kinds of different things are going on. Darwin's running around at this point. Everybody's weighing in on science here. Now, as a partial reaction perhaps, the archaeologist and another American here, Albright, goes into the field. First of all, he comes from a background of theology. He knows the Bible very well, he knows the languages very well, and he is actually sort of reacting to this. But he becomes an archaeologist, and he goes to the Bible land, and he starts to excavate. So from the 1930s to the 1960s or so, archaeologists such as Albright confirm that the Bible is literally true. That's where they start. So they go there looking for the reality in the dirt. This can easily lead to something that's called circular reasoning. I found this, the Bible says this, therefore the Bible's right, and it just keeps going like this. We still deal with this sort of thing today in some way. You can see his quote there, that discovery after discovery has established the accuracy of the Bible. Okay? He was a good archaeologist, and he was a good scholar. He was an excellent scholar. But his belief there, along with his colleagues from several generations even after him, was that the Bible was still correct. The Israelis come along. Now, they expanded into territories after the various wars, and they get into various other areas around in their country or in the territories, and they start to use archaeology in a sense for national identity and nationalism in a sense, proving their past, not just the Bible, but a number of other stories too, such as what Josephus said or other scholars have said in the past. They're trying to rebuild their own history. That's just a sideline. Now, I want to talk to you a little bit about this minimalist reaction to all of this. The minimalist reaction here is starting from the 1980s or so. The Bible is a late document. That's a main thought that they have, and it's not used, should not be used to construct history. So when you can see the quote there, the Bible here, ancient Israel, is a construct of the modern age and shouldn't be taken seriously. This is from Peter Lemke, who comes from the University of Copenhagen, and other scholars like him, which form the Copenhagen School, which is a reaction against the Bible as well. In the end, you can see another quote here from the same author. We have a situation where Israel is not Israel, Jerusalem is not Jerusalem, and David is not David. In other words, the David that we think we know from the biblical tradition never existed. What the Bible says about his kingdom and the processes that lead up to that kingdom, the administration of that kingdom, should be thrown out the window. So in a sense here, we start this reaction, which is the Bible is not true, we should put it aside. And therefore, since we can put it aside, we have no evidence of these guys, Abraham, Moses, all these other people. We need to put all this aside. Then what are we dealing with? Which, once you erase everything from the table, you have to start over with something else. But in the end, they were not dealing with archaeological data. None of these guys from the Copenhagen School actually worked with archaeology, worked in archaeology, or really referred to it too much. Now, we have another important scholar, Israel Finkelstein, who is about to retire from Tel Aviv University, but is, since the 1980s, actually been a champion of some of these ideas. Not only that Israelites did exist, but then he sort of changed around 1990 or so and said, no, we need to down-date some of these numbers. So when I say minimalism as far as an archaeologist goes, we're actually trying to move the dates downward. If the Bible says David lived at 1000 BC and then they go and they excavate and they say, we don't see a processes of a statehood yet. Well, where do we go to look for it? And what they have discovered, Finkelstein and others, is that we need to move the dates down. Jerusalem could not have been a capital in 1000 BC. There was no evidence of it there when we excavate. Okay? That's convenient when you don't have a ton of archaeological materials. But in the last 25 years, and especially the last 10 years, every day there's something new coming up. Archaeology is catching up. The data is getting fuller for these things. So in other words, what he did was he said the transition from rural to social organizations, such as a state, didn't occur at 1,000. It occurred later. So what they're doing is they're minimalizing, in a sense, the dates as well, okay, moving them downward in time. What do you do, though? If you take David from 1,000, where he's got a kingdom and an apparatus of state, and you say, well, none of this ever occurred until 800 BC or even later, and the Bible's not useless for our understanding of this because it's so late, where does David go? Where does Solomon go? So what we end up with here is what he's saying is there were no fortified sites in Judah. Jerusalem was unfortified. There are no sites that are fortified. A kingdom should have fortifications, etc. These are tales for cold winter nights. Now, I will call your attention to one book that he wrote that's actually quite good, Bible Unearthed. It's a bit dated now, certainly. But he wrote this book with this idea of the minimalist school. Again, saying the same sorts of things. The Bible was late, etc. Archaeology should speak for itself. Now, I just challenge, I would put this on the table here, that if you have a text such as the Merneptah Stela or the Tel Dan Stela or any other text, should we not use it critically, constructively towards our understanding of the fuller picture? If we take the Bible out of biblical archaeology, what do we really have? Not a lot. We don't understand a whole lot. Now, I will say this, though. His book is extremely influential. I've read it several times. I enjoy the book. He's got a good point of view here, except the opening pages of his book start with, none of this stuff was created in David's time at 1000 BC. No, it was established in Josiah's time in about 650 BC. Josiah, we have no references, no inscriptions, nothing. So in the sense, what he's done is saying, not David, but Josiah without any evidence. So you can't have it both ways. Well, you can try, I guess. Now, what do we have here? The Bible tells us in 2 Samuel that David became king. What do we do with this tradition? When we add up the biblical tradition, we point to David living at around 1000 BC, according to the biblical tradition, which is all kinds of little gyrations that it does internally to give us this date. It doesn't say on page 14 that David lived in 1000 BC, if you understand what I'm saying here. Now, let me talk to you a little bit, just a few minutes, about this particular site. We're digging here at Kirbet Kaiapha. We have identified this now with biblical Sha'arayim. It's no easy trick to go to any one of 30,000 sites in Israel, just that tiny country of Israel that has 30,000 archaeological sites. You know how many have been excavated? Less than 2%. It's difficult to go to a site that we don't know anything about and expect that we know the site's ancient name. So this is a big problem, too. So this is the site. Over here, in these circles over here, we have the Philistine main capital cities. You probably realize, even if you're not a biblical scholar of any sort, that there was a big problem with the Israelites and the Philistines, most notably the David and Goliath story. Okay, that's one type story. Here's the site over here, sitting on the Elah Valley. Again, very important valley for a number of reasons. Transportation. This valley goes this way towards Hebron, and according to the stories associated with David, that's where David first became king, in Hebron, and then to Jerusalem. All right? Here's the problem, though. Joshua 15 so-and-so says there's a bunch of cities here that belong to Judah. Socho, Azekah, and Sha'arayim. Where are these places? Some of those cities on that list, we don't know where they are today. We can guess. Some have been identified. But how do you expect to find a city if we don't have any references to it? Now, there's a problem with this dating. But what I want to point out to you here is that what we have to expect is that there's memory in these texts that's transmitted for a number of centuries. If you're prepared to go with that, and we can sort of talk about that if you want to at some point, that there's memory in these texts that's transmitted down the centuries. All right? Now, we have the famous David and Goliath story. The problem here is how much is legend, and clearly some of it is. But here's a reference here. The bodies of the Philistines after the battle were scattered along the road from Sha'arayim to Gat and Ekron. Gat and Ekron were the capital cities of the Philistines. We know they are. Sha'arayim, we didn't know where it was. Okay? Now, there's a problem with this text. It could be that this is the way the Israelites wanted to see their relationship with the Philistines. They're the bigger guys, they're stronger, the Israelites are the weaker ones, etc. David's the hero. There's a lot of theological statements wrapped up here. And also, just so you know, there's two references to the guy who beat Goliath. Elchanan is given credit for it in another place. So clearly this is a problematic story in its own, but it does tell us something about the reality of the late 11th century, early 10th century, when Israel and the Philistines were, Judah and the Philistines were actually butting heads together in the valley I just showed you. All right? Our site, Kirbet Kayafa, has this particular chronology. It's dated to about 1025 or 1015 BC, and it's destroyed shortly after, about 25 to 30 years or so it's destroyed, maximum 40 years. And it has massive gates, walls, shows us the transition to the monarchy, etc. Now, when did David live, according to the biblical tradition? According to the internal chronology, if we back it up from certain other events, Solomon ruled here, David ruled somewhere around 1,000, if that's the case. How do we know this? Archaeology needs to come into the game here. Now, archaeology in Israel and other places is usually dated, archaeological features are usually dated by pottery. Pottery changes over time. We have built up a typology of pottery, how it changed from year to year to year to year to century. But this is too close. Solomon and David and Saul probably could have drank from the same cup. Things don't change that quickly. So we need a better burden of proof here. We need a bigger dating scheme. So we turn to carbon 14. Here we have a sealed drain at the site that we actually found olive pits. And long story short, over 28 olive pits have been sent from this one period site that has been collapsed and abandoned after 700 years. We have 28 samples that all come into about 1040 to 960. The average is about 1025 BC, which conveniently fits the processes that we see otherwise, administration and some other things, which then sort of corroborates with the Bible in some sense. Now, this sounds like circular reasoning, except we don't necessarily need the Bible to show us these dates. They don't come from the Bible. Okay? So the statehood. Here are some main theories related to King David. There's the biblical tradition pretty much as is. He's a great king. He ruled from this place to that place. And he did a bunch of wonderful things, including killing Goliath. Okay? There's that. It's mythological. David as the mythological figure. He's a literary figure. The Bible is a late book. The stories are just that, elaborations. Except we have the Merneptah Stele from 1206 and the Tel Dan Stele with this. What do you do with this Tel Dan Stele? It says, not a biblical reference. So the minimalist had to sort of change their outlook on this. After they attacked it as a fraud and a forgery and everything else, they have come to accept it, but it ruins the paradigm. Okay? David is an earlier figure than the Hellenistic period. And then there's the sort of another theory about David, which is the low chronology, more or less this is Finkelstein and others. Statehood was not possible in the 10th century. Therefore, David and Solomon, if they lived in a tent, not in a capital city. That's basically the wording they use. This is based on lack of archaeology, but we don't have that now. We have more archaeology. So carbon 14 dates from Kirbet Kayafa and other sites, by the way. Once Kirbet Kayafa was found at the periphery on the border with the Philistines to match the social setting of the biblical tradition that associated with King David, we have other evidence now. So it's no longer possible to argue from a lack of evidence. And that's one of the biggest threats to the minimalist claim. All right, so let's go quickly through Kirbet Kayafa. Area B, you can see here, when they came to the site, they chose to dig this site because it had massive foundations. You can see them down here. These smaller stones here in the center are actually, you can see how different they are than these major stones here. Some of these stones in the city wall from the Iron Age, dated to the Iron Age by pottery and carbon 14 dating, are from 1025 BC. Later on, when this city was destroyed, the Hellenistic period lapsed, and about 700 years later, the Hellenistic people came in and they blocked up this gate because they had a different sort of urban planning. This was here. That was the first season. That's when I heard about the site back in 2008 and the inscription that was found there, and I decided that would be a great place to go dig. All right, here's the gate when it was partially reconstructed based on the footprint that it left behind. This is massive. If we were going to get together as a group here in this room and decide to make a subdivision or a city, unless we had somebody knew somebody with a truck and a backhoe and everything else, we wouldn't be building city walls with 6-ton stones. Some of them are 10-ton stones. Okay? There's something here that points at administration. Architecture takes engineers like this. Okay? So the city was built, we have found in our research, the city was built on a single plan. Houses were added later, the houses are smaller, and they abut the city wall. This becomes a Judean architectural footprint that lasts centuries into the future. It starts here, it looks like. Okay? Here's an aerial view. Now I'm going to show you an inscription that was found in this second house from the gate over here, found in 2008. This site is incredibly rich. It was destroyed and everything was left behind, so we have a rich supply of materials. This currently, and again, not everybody agrees. I want to make sure you understand this. But most people do agree, most linguists do agree that this is a proto-Canaanite inscription. Five lines of text, and even here, in that particular time, it was read from left to right, not the way it is Hebrew today. The lucky part for us, at least for some of us, is that the grammar in this is pointing to what is early Hebrew. Okay, some grammatical forms. The existence of this writing tells us, if we can understand what it says, that the biblical tradition is not just something we read in the Bible. There are earlier precedents. And this is, again, another example from this particular site. Now, understand this is a very generous translation, very liberal, by Gershom Galil of Haifa University. And you can see what are some of the things that it's talking about here. Some of the language in red, most people agree. He's filled in some others. But because we need something to talk about here, understand there are some contra opinions about this. But this is the key thing here for the grammar. Do not do is, in this particular form, al ta'as, which is in Hebrew. It doesn't appear in other languages at this time. Okay? So, what do we have? What turns out to be not just a list of commodities is what we usually find, but this turns out to be sort of a prophetic text. I'll just invite you, if you're interested, to look at like Isaiah 1 or Isaiah 51, where you see very similar sorts of languages, or terminology and references here. All right? So, one of the minimalist claims was, you can't have a kingdom without writing or literacy. We don't have any literacy. We have no examples. Back in the 1980s, there were precious few. So therefore, there's no kingdom. Well, that's not true anymore. Again, archaeology keeps adding to the Bible, where the Bible, more or less, we can interpret it differently, is more or less fixed, unless we find a new treasure trove of texts. You see what I'm saying? Archaeology is adding to it, not taking it away. So it's perfectly fine to say this in 1980, but you can't say it anymore. You want to know Israel Finkelstein's reaction to this text? I was there. I heard it. He said, they asked him, what do you think about the Kerba Kayafa text, the five-line inscription I just showed you? He said, bunch of scribbles. At first, that's what we thought, too, until we started working with it. Now, in 10 years, in 20 years, you'll still be seeing articles about this. So just you heard it here sort of first. All right, area. In 2009, we joined, our archaeology program joined the dig in 2009. So much was found in the first year, it was just a treasure trove. Here we had a beautiful site, pristine, locked in a 700-year vacuum, and there it was where we dug below the surface. All right, so there we go. We go over here to this particular part of the site, over here in C, area C, and we found the second gate. Everybody should go, oh, wow. Well, you don't have any reason to do that, but let me explain this to you. Massive foundations like the first gate were found on the other side. We dug it away, and within 2 weeks, we had the same size gate. Within centimeters, the same plan, okay? A few people know this in this room. What is biblical Sha'arayim? We didn't know. It's hard to find a biblical site. In Hebrew, Sha'ar is gate. In the plural in Hebrew can add im or ayim, and there's ways to interpret this, believe me, other ways to interpret this. But Sha'arayim means two gates. You say, great, we have two gates. This is the only two gates city ever found in Israel. Is it a coincidence? The archaeology director, I just met with him, he was here for 3 days. I said, you know, after all this, it's 10 years now since you started really digging that site. He said, doesn't that ever really sort of bother you that they built two gates in a small 6-acre site? It's vulnerable. Even sites 10 times this size have one gate. He said, I think they made a mistake. Or we don't understand why. But it's possible that Shah Rahim was so unique, so different, that maybe its name was Two Gates. Who knows? But this trickled down. What's interesting in the text, there are three references to this Shah Rahim. One is problematic, but they're all referring to the 10th century. So there is biblical memory that translates. When the writers are writing it all down in the 7th century, 6th century, whatever it happens to be, they're actually using older sources and memories that are in the society. I'm way over time. I knew I would be. All right, two gates. Here's the way they look, side by side. These are casemate walls. You say, how exciting. And I agree with you. These casemate walls are like this. From the city gate, they go this way. This is a house. This is a house. Here you have an entrance into what is called a casemate. It helps the wall stand up and it makes it strong without filling in all the rest. Plus, it can be used for storage and can billet troops and whatever else. It could be public and private. This becomes a Judean architectural standard. Here we have an early example. The Philistines didn't do this. The Canaanites didn't do it. The Egyptians were the only ones around. They left already. They didn't do this. So we are talking about an early example of Judean architecture and state planning, and et cetera, et cetera. Okay? We dug almost 30% of this site. Here's the gate, the casemates, and the buildings. That's unusual, by the way. 10% is a lot in an archaeological site. Here are some other sites back in Judea, known as Judean sites from centuries later, all using the same architectural standard. This becomes a Judean innovation. Sorry. And cult. We have lots of cultic materials. Here's one cultic room where we found inside things we've never seen before. It's an early example of Judean everything, house styles, architecture, and cult. So what I mean by cult is the apparatus of worship, of whatever it was. I don't want to call it religion. But in a sense, if you look at it, it's good old-fashioned biblical religion. Standing stones, installations, we don't know a lot about what they did because the Bible really doesn't tell us too much. Archaeology, we can guess. Now, here's some of the things that were found, crazy things. We don't know how to interpret yet. But what we did not find were statues of naked ladies or, you know, that sort of thing, fertility type objects, which the Bible doesn't really like too much. All right, so they seem quite conservative in that way. All right, also in 2012, we found this area up here, the largest Iron Age building. And the center of the site, which is an administrative building. Unfortunately, when the Byzantines came later on, unfortunately for us, they built almost right on top of it. But all we can say about it is the black lines here are actually from the Iron Age. This is the largest Iron Age. Now, I'm not saying, nor should you interpret that I'm saying David went there and ruled. That's not what I'm saying. All right, so let's end it here. What this particular site has shown us, we think, is the Bible says this, the United Monarchy was established. It's pretty confident about that when you read the text. United Monarchy meaning David and Solomon ruled over Israel and Judah, but we don't see the same processes in the northern part, which was ancient Israel. We see it in Judah, but not there. So the Bible seems to like this. We have to think about what that exactly means. And Judah came later, and then Israel came later, and Judah lasts longer because Israel was destroyed in 722 BC by the Assyrians. The minimalists claimed nobody was capable of a state. In other words, down-date these dates to the 900, right around 900. Israel is first, and then Judah came later because it was poor and backwater and everything else. Okay, that's based on a lack of archaeological evidence. Kerba Kayafa, and our interpretation is, okay, we don't see a united monarchy either, but we see that these state processes occurred as early as 1000 BC. Israel lasted all the way till 586 when the Babylonians destroyed it. Judah lasted that long. And Israel came along and then was destroyed as well. So I guess the upshot here is, because I'm out of time, is that the Bible is being added to. And so in some cases, we can see where the Bible has actually been justified a little bit anyway on archaeological data. I'm not one, by the way, who says the Exodus happened exactly as it says in the Bible. I don't see that. nor do I go out looking for Noah's Ark. So, I mean, there are some archaeological things we can talk about, especially in the 10th century. All right, thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Pitlick. Okay, well, next here from Dr. Robert M. Price on Christianity, the New Testament, and Jesus.
It is great to be back here. I thoroughly enjoyed the event 3 years ago and hope to come back again. I'd like to read you a poem by Thomas Hardy called The Respectable Burgher, Villager, Townsman, on the Higher Criticism. Since reverend doctors now declare that clerks and people must prepare to doubt if Adam ever were, to hold the flood a local scare, to argue, though the stolid stare, that everything that happened ere the prophets to its happening swear, that David was no giant slayer, nor one to call a god obeyer, in certain details we could spare, but rather was a debonair, shrewd bandit, skilled as banjo player, that Solomon sang the fleshly fair, and gave the church no thought whate'er, that Esther with her royal wear, and Mordecai the son of Jair, and Joshua's triumphs, Job's despair, and Balaam's ass's bitter blare, Nebuchadnezzar's furnace flare, and Daniel and the den affair, and other stories rich and rare, were writ to make old doctrine wear something of a romantic air. That the Nain widow's only heir, and Lazarus with cadaverous glare, as done in oils by Piombo's care, did not return from Sheol's lair, that jail set a fiendish snare, that Pontius Pilate acted square, that never a sword cut Malchus' ear, and but for shame I must forbear that Jesus did not reappear. Since thus they hint, nor turn a hair, all church going will I forswear, and sit on Sundays in my chair and read that moderate man Voltaire. So there's the impact of the higher criticism or historical criticism. This was a big storm intellectually and beginning of the 18th, I guess, but in the 19th century, where critical methods were applied to the Bible, since it certainly appeared through archaeology and evolution and so on, that it wasn't quite kosher, that what the ancient scriptures say, things that you're liable to read in the Bible ain't necessarily so. This was really a blow. The higher criticism, the term back then, which I still like and use, referred to studies of the questioning, the authorship, the authority, the factual character or lack of it of the Bible, and it tended to suggest that, yeah, there's not a whole lot of history in it, there's not a lot of accuracy in it. And the authorship, oh boy, were the books of Moses, Genesis through Deuteronomy, really written by Moses? Seems a little unlikely, since it speaks of Moses already as an ancient figure. Did any one writer compose the Pentateuch, the five books? Maybe not. It looked like that if you counted up the statistics and stylistic differences and all that, it appeared that there are different versions of this, but that there were four major sources, the J source for the Yahweh or Jehovah and Judah and so forth, the E source a bit later, some of the same stories of Moses and the patriarchs and so on, that was from Ephraim or Israel in the north and spoke of God under the name Elohim. Then the P source or the priestly source, which is filled with soporific statistics and all sorts of ritual minutiae that only seems boring because the wrong people are reading it. These were like priestly professors. professional textbooks. Like, you know, I don't sit around and read auto repair manuals for fun. Nobody does, but luckily for us, auto mechanics do. Well, that's the way it was. Actually, it appears that the Bible was largely written by scribes, an elite for scribes, kind of like us stuffed shirts going to the Society of Biblical Literature and pontificating about niceties of interpretation and all that. Most people would never have access to these texts, and no printing press yet, right? So how would you even know? I mean, you'd hear snippets of it eventually read in synagogue and all that, but even that's fairly late. These things were not written for a popular audience, and so it takes some adjusting when we do read them. Source criticism. Suppose it turns out that the book of Isaiah was written by numerous prophetic writers, and that the book breaks down into at least two major sections written at different times in history, not by a single Isaiah. Well, that's given people fits. Suppose the book of Daniel was not written by Daniel and was written in the second century, not way back in the sixth, and as purported, and it on and on it goes. The Psalms weren't really written by David, and this just shook a lot of people up. The higher criticism did prevail for a long time, and in other senses it still does. I mean, a lot of the specific conclusions and theories have changed. Of course, scholarly theories evolve and rise and fall. But what was the alternative? If you had higher criticism, there had to be lower criticism. That was textual criticism, the analysis of manuscripts, comparing them to see if we can discern where there had been embellishment and errors in copying. Because again, long before printing presses and Xerox machines, if you wanted new copies when the old ones wore out, you had to have people taking dictation from someone reading it aloud, or just looking back at the old copy and making a new one. And it's pretty darn easy to make mistakes, right? If you ever copied your own stuff and seen a string of the same word and so forth, we can see that the ancients were no different. And so it's interesting that lower criticism or textual criticism survived and flourished in conservative as well as literal, as well as liberal modernist directions, because those who believe the Bible was word for word inspired had more motive than anybody else to try to discern the original readings of the text, because if they're the words of God, you want to make sure you got the right ones. And so, to their great credit, there were various Plymouth Brethren and other fundamentalist scholars, genuine scholars, who wouldn't have touched the higher criticism with a 10-foot pole and regarded it as unbelieving assaults on the Bible, who, however, became great champions of textual or lower criticism. And so both continued. And everybody's interested in textual criticism, all wings of scholarship, and there's largely unanimity on that. But the higher criticism, historical criticism, boy, what a controversy. This was sort of ironic because it was inherent in the Protestant impulse from the beginning, because as I'm sure you know, that Martin Luther and the early Lutherans and Reformed and the others, John Calvin and John Knox and all these guys, rejected a figurative, allegorical interpretation of the Bible, such as was very old. It had been practiced, was borrowed from the Stoics, and a lot of early Christian theologians dealt with difficulties in the Bible by saying, well, Origen said there are hundreds of absurdities, is the word he used, in the Gospels alone. But did that make him say, well, to hell with it then? No, he said these difficulties, he said, for instance, no adult believes a snake spoke to a man. Well, does that mean you discard it as stupid? No, he said, you're supposed to gag when you come to this stuff. It's supposed to be a little red light flashing saying, hey, there's got to be a deeper meaning than this. It doesn't make sense literally, so do some mining. And so they had various methods of plumbing the depths of Scripture, some of it rather fanciful. I mean, once you start in that direction, the Bible becomes a ventriloquist dummy, right? You can make it say whatever you want. And so it easily caricatures itself. Well, Martin Luther and the others didn't care for that approach because they saw all sorts of doctrines and practices in Roman Catholicism that they could not find taught literally in the Bible, and to some degree they had been derived from an allegorical reading, and reading between the lines, reading behind the lines. And Martin Luther said, look, if the Bible is to be any kind of an authority, you can't use sacred methods, sacred hermeneutics, to use a $5 word. You have to interpret the Bible like you would any other ancient text, the Odyssey, the Gallic Wars of Caesar, whatever, the Metamorphoses of Ovid. Yeah, the Bible is the inspired word of God, Luther said, but how do you know what the word of God is saying? Well, oh, let's say God inspired it. What did he inspire? A human text written in human language, human words, human grammars. So what difference does it make for the Bible to be inspired? Well, after you read it, as you would any other secular text, then you take it extra seriously because it's the inspired word of God. But you don't start rewriting it by reinterpreting it in some mystical, allegorical way. This was called the grammatico-historical method of interpretation, that you have to read it like any other text according to the grammar of the Greek and the Hebrew and the Aramaic, and according to what we can know about the history of the time that that these various writings were composed. And I mean, words change in meaning over time, so you got to try to get back to what the writer would have thought his readers would understand. It's not easy to do, it's not always possible to do, but that ought to be the goal. If you want to take the Bible seriously as the Word of God, you got to approach it as if it weren't just plain old human speech, and then you take it more seriously. Well, Luther and Calvin and these other reformers still believed that it was the Word of God, and there were certain implications of that for them. It couldn't contradict itself, because if the Bible writers were basically stenographers for God, if Scripture had a single author, as they often said, then you couldn't find contradictions in doctrine or errors of fact in it. I mean, what, God doesn't know what he's talking about? That God got the duration of the flood wrong? It's absurd. And you could see, you know, how they would say that. But the more people read it, especially with the aid of archaeology and biology and these other things exploding in the 19th century, it became pretty hard to deny that there were big problems with it. And so what did literalists, fundamentalists, biblicists, whatever you want to call them, what did they do when they came smack dab into these things? They said, well, maybe the real meaning of it is not apparent to us. Maybe if you, like, do Paul and James contradict one another on justification? James appears to say that you are not justified, saved, accepted in the eyes of God by mere faith. Works are necessary too. Does Paul say, oh no, good works come into it subsequently. You are justified in the eyes of God by faith alone. Uh-oh, that sounds kind of contradictory. What are you gonna do? If you admit it is a contradiction, look what happens. You can no longer believe the statement simply because it appears in the Bible. It's right there in the book of James. Oh, yeah, but the other one is right there in the epistle to the Romans. They're both in the Bible, right? Well, Martin Luther was more honest with himself than some. He did see this as an irreconcilable contradiction, and so his solution was, let's get James the hell out of the Bible. And Jude and the book of Revelation, somebody ought to go throw that in the River Elba. He was a pretty gutsy guy, so he said, if you do find these big contradictions, somebody made a mistake including him in the canon. At least that was consistent, right? But of course that hardly begins to deal with the problems that riddle the texts. So a later generation turned the grammatico-historical method into the historical-critical method, saying, well, we're supposed to treat it like it was any other text. When you read Caesar's Gallic Wars or the Odyssey or something, do you refuse to admit there might be inaccuracies? Are you unwilling to recognize contradictions? Of course not. This is what human beings do. They screw up sometimes, and they have different opinions side by side. If we don't admit that, we are retreating basically to allegory again. Right? This idea that there's some meaning beyond the literal apparent meaning that if it were true, that would solve the problem. Like if we could get Shirley MacLaine in here and start channeling Paul and say, oh, Apostle, what did you mean by this? Paul would say, darn, I knew I shouldn't have put it that way. I really meant what my pal James said. But it doesn't actually say that. Right, so you're departing from the literal, straightforward sense. You can't be consistent that way. And so those who embraced historical criticism said, let's admit what we're seeing. Let's take the blinders off. Let's be honest with the text, even at the price, even at the cost of not being able to treat it as an absolute authority anymore. You know, the bumper sticker says, some of the best theology is in bumper stickers, I think, and jokes. There's one that says, the Bible said it, I believe it, that settles it. Well, the problem is, if you're pretending that the Bible says what it ought to say, what you really mean is, I said it, the Bible believed it, that settles it. The Bible as a ventriloquist dummy, what's the point? You're back to where Martin Luther was on the allegory. If you treat it like this, it's not an authority. If you decide which way it goes, you're the authority. Why don't you just admit that and forget about the authority of the Bible? Use your own brain, as Jesus says in the Gospel of Luke. Why do you not judge for yourselves what is right? That one doesn't get quoted very often. There are various things I've intimated already. The higher criticism included source criticism, where you realize, yeah, this isn't a straightforward account. It's a bunch of documents pieced together, and that's why they differ. That's very important, right? If in one passage in Exodus, God says, this is the name I want to be remembered by throughout all generations, Jehovah, whatever, and your predecessors knew me as El Shaddai, which seems to mean God Almighty, but from now on I want to be known as Yahweh or Jehovah. But then you look back in Genesis and they're calling God Jehovah all the time. How is it, you know, what happened here? You assume, yeah, Moses wrote the whole thing and he was schizophrenic. He was a multiple personality who said this and then no. You can solve the problem by saying no. People stitch together different stories with different opinions. Luckily, they didn't cut it out, forget it. They had a patchwork quilt, a scrapbook, which is mighty good to have. You see what you're doing there? This approach to the Bible solves the problems, not in the way you might have wanted, right? People say, well, I don't see how this could be true and that could be true, but once we get to heaven, we'll have a big seminar and they'll explain, son of a gun, why didn't I think of that? That's just fanciful. I prefer an approach to the Bible that actually solves the puzzles rather than leaving them or creating puzzles. The same sort of thing with form criticism, which basically was a way of trying to isolate units of oral tradition that people pass down, individual stories or rituals or parables or sayings, and that they were later on integrated into a text. Redaction criticism, you compare one gospel to another, or you compare the Deuteronomic books to the Chronicles, and you say, hey, this one seems to change this one, and that's very illuminating. This remains controversial, and why is that? Well, because it becomes obvious if any of these methods seem to work, that you're opening up a wider and wider gap between the supposed events and the texts which purport to tell us about them. It'd be much better to say, from a dogmatic Orthodox standpoint, well, we know the Red Sea parted because Moses was there and he wrote this, and so forth. But suppose Moses had nothing to do with it and we're dealing with orally transmitted materials and several versions of them that have just been placed there cheek by jowl. Doesn't look like it's based on eyewitness testimony. Why did that become important? The belief that many still stick by today that, oh yeah, we know that Jesus really did this and that because the Gospels are based on eyewitness testimony. We know what Jeremiah said because his secretary Baruch took dictation and so on. You know, all is as it was, but you are there. Well, a lot of folks don't like that. They don't like the uncertainty. Where did this notion, this desperation to find eyewitness material come from? Historically, Christians didn't necessarily believe that. They believed that the Bible narrative was accurate without error because God had inspired it. He virtually dictated it. The result was the same, however he did it. So who cares if it was written down hundreds of years after the fact, if it was the product of divine inspiration? A strange kind of a hybrid, it's hard even to imagine anymore, came about in the 18th century in the wake of Newtonian physics and all this, where religious, pious, devout people no longer believed in miracles. They liked a kind of mechanistic view of natural law. Things happen according to the laws whereby God created the world. They figured it's great evidence that God did create it, that all of these regularities in nature happen. You think it was just an accident? Well, high price tag on this, because if you said there weren't actual miracles, it was all carefully programmed timing, like the locusts, plague, it was just the wind blowing the little critters off course and all that, and it's just timing at the Red Sea and all that. What they felt they had to do was to save the appearances, as Owen Barfield said, the idea that the stuff in the Bible did happen, but of course the Bible writers, not being modern men of science, couldn't have understood how. So they just jumped the gun and figured it was direct miracles pulled off by God like a cosmic magician. But these guys in the 18th century said, okay, it wasn't that. But it all happened. People seemed to see Jesus walking on the water. Well, he was actually walking by the water and they were still close to the shore and didn't realize it. Or he knew where the stepping stones were, or he was water skiing behind the boat or something. And they had these amazingly elaborate, ingenious, but usually ridiculous explanations for how it really happened. Jesus was crucified and he was seen alive 3 days later, but gee, does that mean God miraculously restored him to life? No, he passed out on the cross. They thought he was dead, and he revived 3 days later. That's it. That's the ticket. Well, once you say there are no miracles, there can be no miraculous inspiration of the text either. So there goes the old guarantee of its accuracy. And they had to say, well, it could be accurate if eyewitnesses wrote it. And that's it. It must all be written by the people that took part in it. Of course, that doesn't really work. And people are still debating this like crazy. And there's fundamentalists often say that if you begin to doubt the text and its accuracy here, eventually you'll be doubting it there. If you say that there was no Adam, eventually you're going to say there was no Jesus. It's just a slippery slope. They're right. I'm afraid they're right. Once the critical approach of doubting and testing is introduced, there is no way to consistently stop it, and the extreme versions would be Old and New Testament minimalism. saying that, well, it might have happened, but there's no definitive reason to say so. And if it looks like it did happen in the current state of the evidence, next week somebody may dig up something else that'll prove it didn't. So you just can't have that absolute confidence anymore. And so Old Testament minimalism, New Testament minimalism, otherwise known as mythicism. There are some of us tinfoil hat wearing crazy people that think that there is nothing but fiction in the New Testament. Well, the first time Thomas L. Thompson and others espoused Old Testament minimalism, that was it for Thompson in the academic community. He had to make a living by painting houses. And you might say, well, at least that was honest work with real results. But then a couple of decades later, it becomes a big going concern and loads of people are minimalists. It doesn't sound so crazy anymore. Right now, weirdos like me who think that probably even Jesus was a mythical figure, we're still looked at as lunatics, but you never know, the winds may change. You can never predict what's going to happen, and indeed that is the whole point of a historical approach. All judgments must be tentative and provisional, always open to revision, or you're going to be pretty embarrassed sooner or later.
Thank you, Dr. Price. Okay, we'll hear finally on Islam from Dr. Herbert Byrd.
Hello. I guess I'm going to apologize. I have no pictures and no poem. But I do appreciate that what has gone before, because when one talks about Islam, particularly in a critical, historical critical way, often the charge of Orientalism is leveled, and I don't have necessarily a problem with that criticism of it. I think that many of the people I'm going to talk about could be called Orientalists in the negative sense of that word. But it does show that what happened in Islam, particularly at the end of the 19th century and throughout the 20th century, is part of a process that happened in all the other traditions as well. So it wasn't as though scholars were necessarily picking on Islam for some nefarious reasons. So when scholars examine the formation of Islam, by which I mean the period roughly of 150 years from the time of about 610, when Muhammad is said to have had his first revelation, to the establishment of the Abbasid Caliph and the downfall of the Umayyads in the year 750, they focus on three kinds of texts. The Quran, which is the scripture of Islam, and I'm assuming some of you have zero knowledge of Islam, so I'm going to give some explanations for these terms. The Sunnah, the thousands of traditions or hadiths about what Muhammad said and did, that usually have a paradigmatic or legal status for most Muslims, and the Sirah, the biography of the Prophet Muhammad. In each case, arguments have been put forth not to treat these literatures as historical sources that recount what actually happened, but rather what later Muslims believed happened. That is, they present sacred history rather than history. And although the Quran and Sunnah have a far greater role in Islam than the Sirah, I'll deal with them briefly and devote more time to the Sirah before this material presents itself as history and the subject matter and the issues surrounding it more closely parallel the concerns that my fellow panelists have brought up already. But the Quran first. Traditionally, the Quran is believed to be of divine origin, a claim that the Quran itself advances. It was brought from a heavenly archetype to Muhammad via the angel Gabriel, and the prophet recited, remembered, and abrogated only what God wished. The Quran could be said, therefore, to have been a fixed canon in Muhammad's lifetime. His Muslim followers needed only compile it, which occurred soon after his death, under the auspices of one or more of the first three caliphs, Abu Bakr, Umar, or Uthman, depending on which of the conflicting hadiths one reads. The Quran, as skeptical scholars, and I often use the word skeptical, but here we would say minimalist, I think, what they have suggested is that the Quran may have been canonized much later than Muslim tradition claims. Moreover, though the materials that came to be present in the Quran predate their canonization, they may have originated even in a non-Meccan, non-Medinan milieu, so somewhere else outside of Arabia, perhaps even. Fairly recently discovered or rediscovered manuscripts or fragments of the Quran have been carbon dated, suggest that the Quran is perhaps a little bit older than skeptics have suggested, and so may lend some credence to the traditional account of the formation of Islam. Nevertheless, there are lots of reasons, or at least problems, that undermine the using the or undermine using the Quran as a reliable historical text. But most scholars of Islam have no qualms about treating it as a historical source. A good example of this would be Alfred T. Welsh from Michigan State University, who has argued, quote, a distinctive feature of the Quran that cannot be ignored if the Muslim scriptures to be understood fully is its close relationship to the life of Muhammad and his contemporaries. The Quran is a historical document that reflects the prophetic career of Muhammad and responds constantly to the specific needs and problems of the emerging Muslim community. It abounds in references and allusions to historical events that occurred during the last 20 years or so of Muhammad's lifetime, unquote. In other words, the Sirah, the biography of the Prophet, confirms the historicity of the contents of the Quran and vice versa. Some have argued, despite the fact that the Quran only mentions Muhammad's name four times, that is the only reliable source for historical information about Muhammad. I'll defer to challenging that claim to my discussion on the Sirah. Next, I'd like to turn to the Sunnah. The Sunnah, embodied in the form of hadith, stands second only to the Quran in terms of authority. Hadiths of the Sunnah in the six canonical Sunni collections are generally considered authentic, particularly those contained in the collections of al-Bukhari and Muslim. There are different Shi'i collections of hadiths and a somewhat broader concept of Sunnah because it includes the Imams. But for all, the authenticity of each matan, or the actual report of a hadith, the thing that says, here's the shortest one I know. I saw Muhammad eating cucumbers and dates. Okay, usually they're much longer, talking about various sorts of things. But this is guaranteed by something called an isnad, or a chain of transmitters, for which the reliability of each listed transmitter has been thoroughly checked. Most of these hadiths have legal implications, are often sort of devoid of even historical detail, so not particularly interesting to us. Nevertheless, at the first glance, there seems to be a wealth of material, much larger than that of early Christianity. In step the two Orientalists, Ignaz Goldsacher and Joseph Schacht, and they are largely responsible for instilling widespread doubt about the authenticity of hadiths. The former's suspicion was prompted by several observations: their apparent oral transmission, at least initially, the proliferation of hadiths in later collections. The quantity just goes up. For instance, just give a quick example from my own work. One person said, I know no more than 100 authentic hadiths from Ibn Abbas on the issue of commentary on the Quran. In At-Tabari, a few centuries later, there are 6,600 at least hadiths, okay? Something exploded in a period of 100 years. Also, if you look at just regular hadiths, their apparent greater familiarity with Muhammad by his younger companions compared to his older ones, presumably the ones who knew him the longest, and perhaps most damning, the almost constant contradictory nature of them. You can often find, especially for the legal hadiths, a hadith that says exactly the opposite. Goldsacher therefore urged, and I quote, skeptical caution rather than optimistic trust, and suggested that hadiths said more about later Muslims than about Muhammad and the origins of Islam. Schacht, for his part, focused on the origins of Islamic law and the role of Ash-Shafi, who died in the year 820, in championing the Sunnah as embodied solely in the form of hadiths as a basis for Islamic law, second only to the Quran. Schacht argued that hadiths were an innovation that postdated the development of law. Originally, the concept referred to something called the living tradition. This is the ideal practice of the community. And it was Shafi who identified the Sunnah exclusively with hadiths from the Prophet. And because of his efforts to secure supreme authority for hadiths, many of the hadiths preserved in the classical collections originated as fictitious expressions of pre-existing legal doctrine. That is, the legal school started putting their own teachings into the form of hadiths. And initially they cited a successor, that is the second generation Muslims. Then it seems that as competition increased, they went to companions, and eventually they were raised to the level of the Prophet. And the consequences of this sort of backwards growth of the isnads was summarized by Schacht: the more perfect the isnad, the later the tradition. Moreover, the competition between legal schools not only had the isnads growing longer, but also spreading, because you wouldn't want to be charged, oh, there's only one tradition that says that. So somebody would invent a new transmission for the same report, but of a different isnad. Now, what happens is, if you look at these things, you have related hadiths, and they all sort of culminate on one person. And Schacht used the term common link. So he thought that you could actually date it, so that if this person is, you know, one person transmits all this way to this person, then suddenly it spreads out. That's the guy who started it, right? Just like when you're tracing back a rumor. If it all converges on one person, you know that person probably started that rumor. And so for Shaikh, the Muslim Isnad analysis that just looked at the biographies of the various people who had transmitted things, which is the core of the Muslim scholarship on hadith, is, quote, irrelevant for the purposes of historical analysis. Now, many scholars, Muslims and non-Muslims alike, have challenged this skepticism or minimalism. The most successful and ardent is Harold Motzke, who championed a what I call a neo-common link theory, in which he calls it the Isnad cum Matan methodology. So he's using both of these methods, looking at both of these things, the Isnad and the report itself. And it's not unlike redaction criticism, which you just referred to. It seeks to determine the provenance or authenticity of closely related hadiths by comparing their isnads and their matans. The method can only be employed if there are a sufficient number of related hadiths that permit comparisons. You can't do it with one if there's a purport and there's only one isnad and it's a single sort of thing. You need a great number of them. Although skeptics might take issue with this assumption, whether or not there is a correlation between the isnads and the matans. If you're going to be skeptical about the isnad system, you sort of dismiss, you throw out the baby with the bathwater in this case. But Motzke makes at least one good point. If you're willing to concede that the later compilers, the people who actually wrote the books, did not go so far as to invent names of their informants, then Motzke's methods can be employed, at least at that level. That is, if one can find several transmissions of the same or similar hadiths in different compilations from the same informant, and the compilers weren't copying from each other and weren't modifying the isnad, then one can compare those two reports with each other. And if the reports are identical, you might say, well, yes, that they probably got it from the same guy. And you can just keep redoing this over and over again so that you can go from the informant to the informant's informants to the informant's informant's informants and work back trying to create something that might be earlier. Now, to put this a little more formally, the way Motzke would say it, to use the method, one first collects all the variants of a tradition, then creates a diagram of the transmission history based on the isnads to highlight common links and partial common links. Then one groups the matans connected to those links for a synoptic comparison, that is, looking at them together, and analyzes both the matans, including the motifs and the themes, even the word choice and order, and the isnads to see if there's a correlation between them. One should then be able to determine much about the original matan transmitted by the link, at times even to reconstruct what the original version of the story was, and who, if anyone, adapted the report in transmitting it from the link. Not surprisingly, this methodology shows most hadiths to be much older than suggested by Goldsicher and Schacht. Given that the Sira, which is, I said, the biography of Muhammad and the most historical or claims to be historical. This also comes in the form of hadith. So I'm going to take a shot at Motzke in a few minutes after I talk about the Sira. Now the Sira is preserved in many forms and recensions. Those of Ibn Ishaq via someone called Ibn Hisham, and that of At-Tabari are considered the most authoritative. Even though they were chronologically arranged, as I've just noted, most of the Sira comes in the form of hadiths and are contained in collections just as the ones I mentioned, and were produced 2 centuries or more after the events they purport to describe. Consequently, any doubts you have about legal hadiths seem to apply to the historical Sira hadiths as well. I should put the historical part in quotation marks, as that is part of what we're asking here. These doubts cannot be allayed with the claim that the Quran is intimately connected with Muhammad, and that one only need to read the Sira to see the constant references. John Wansborough, in the late 1970s, pointed out that much of the Sira appears to be narrative exegesis of the Quran, or interpretation of the Quran. The Quran served to provide concepts, not historical facts. So what we have is not historical evidence for Muhammad, but evidence of the historization of the figure of Muhammad. Just to give you one quick example. So when the Sira talks about Muhammad becoming an orphan, and Quran 96 says, did he not find you an orphan and give you refuge? Did he not find you lost and guide you? And he found you poor and made you self-sufficient. It is not a case of both the Quran and the Sirah being two independent sources confirming one basic historical fact. That's something Welsh would actually suggest, or has suggested. Rather, it's merely an example of how the Sirah's narrative developed as a way to explain this really vague passage that never names its antecedent. Wandsbrough concludes, and I quote, "The historical value of the Muslim scripture lies, it seems to me, not in its role as a source for the biography of Muhammad, but rather as a source for the concepts that eventually applied to composition of the Muslim theology of prophethood." He's known for his very wordy sentences. But not surprisingly, therefore, the Quran does seem to confirm the biographical details of Muhammad's life. And no doubt the two texts are intimately connected, just not in the way that Welsh suggests. This kind of skepticism, or minimalism, prompted scholars to defend Sirah the same way Motzki tried to defend other hadiths. The most prominent scholars who did that are Gregor Schuller and Andreas Gorki. Schuller attempts to prove that the historical materials can be discerned within the Sirah, particularly the Sirah of the person who first collected this material. It's ascribed to someone called Urwa ibn Zubayr, who died in the year 711. And now we're within a century of Muhammad, and therefore this matters, at least according to Schuller, and whose material was later employed both by Ibn Ishaq, and therefore Ibn Hisham, and by At-Tabari. Urwa's book is completely lost, but his students further redacted it and preserved it in several forms. Schuller tries to recover that what he calls the Ur-text, a nice good German word, the lost original version of the text. By comparing various forms that still exist, Schuller believes he can reconstruct the earlier version of the reports. His method involves comparison of traditions that share an early transmitter and searching for similarities in wordings, meanings, and ordering of motifs in hopes of discerning a transmitter's recension. Having applied the technique, Schuller suggests that at least the main features of some of the reports about Muhammad's time in Medina are authentic. He's developed a sophisticated and rigorous methodology for this sort of things. And by the way, hopefully you realize it sounds very much like what Motzki doing. It is almost identical. Interestingly, not all of the accounts are shown to be historical. In fact, others who have applied this methodology often come to negative conclusions, even Motzki sometimes. For example, Jens Scheiner's analysis about the reports of the conquest of Damascus shows them to be much later. Schuller himself is forced to conclude that one of the most important critical texts about Muhammad and the Quran, that is the very first revelation of Muhammad on Mount Hira in the cave with the angel Gabriel, he cannot be certain any part of it is accurate, despite its production or close to the lifetime of the people who lived with Muhammad. In fact, people often latch on that story, think, here's good evidence that it's not true, that the methodology is problematic. I actually go the other way. To me, the fact that you can come up with negative conclusions sometimes suggests that the methodology might have some merit. However, others, for instance, Stephen Shoemaker, has argued that the attempt by Gorki and Schuller to reconstruct Urwa's Sirah relies too much on the common link analysis, and there are insufficient versions, or to use his terminology, their networks of transmission are usually not dense enough. He concludes that such efforts, and I quote, "to push beyond Ibn Ishaq's Sirah into the first century of Islam are disappointingly limited. For the knowledge of this period, we must continue to rely on the traditional principles of matan analysis as advanced by Goldsicher and Schacht in consultation with careful analysis of contemporary non-Islamic sources," end quote. But this is not my issue with Schuller, Gorki, and Motzki's methodology. Having meticulously compared hundreds of versions of various events, Schuller and Gorki may even be correct in their conclusion that Urwa's corpus included the stories of Muhammad's first revelation, the reactions of the Meccans, the harassment of the Muslims, their flight to Abyssinia, and the later emigration to Medina, even the military conflict between the Meccans up to the conquest of Mecca. Conveniently, by the way, if you read what they think is actually part of Urwa, the fantastic elements such as Muhammad's night journey, the ascension to heaven, the more problematic ones such as the reference to the satanic verses, and the many conflicts with the Jews seem to be absent from the reconstructed text. But then they add this significant claim, and this is where I'm going to start challenging them, The material that can be securely ascribed to Urwa was collected some 30 to 60 years after Muhammad's death. It would therefore go back to eyewitnesses and to persons in very close contact with Muhammad. It may therefore be assumed that these reports reflect the general outline of events correctly, unquote. Motzke regularly makes the exact same claim. This all boils down to close enough, or put more eloquently, since I'm an academic, I have to do it that way, chronological proximity implies greater historical authenticity. Ordinarily, I actually agree with that claim, unless there are some mitigating circumstances that force us to ask, does closing the gap between the texts that we have and the events they purport to describe from 200 years to less than 100 years, or perhaps even as little as 20 years, make the seerah or a hadith historical? I think there are such mitigating circumstances. And here, Christian origins tells us a cautionary tale. Just two decades separate the historical Jesus, if there is a historical Jesus, from Paul's Christ. And the Jesus, the miracle worker in the Gospel of Mark, to the cosmic Lord in the Gospel of John. As William Arnell points out, and sorry for the long quote, but it sums it up perfectly, the nature of the sources for Jesus exacerbates the situation. While the object of our supposedly historical inquiry keeps transforming into a theological entity in front of our eyes, the main sources on which we base our reconstructions present him as a theological entity in the first place. Whether Jesus himself existed as a historical figure or not, the Gospels that tell of him are unquestionably mythic texts. The Gospel of Mark, for example, is a narrative that includes a cast of characters comprising, inter alia, God, the Son of God, angels, the devil, demons, holy spirits, evil spirits, what seem to be the ghosts of Moses and Elijah. It is a story that features miraculous healings, exorcisms, as well as walking on water, feeding thousands of people with a handful of loaves and fishes twice, face-to-face conversations between people who live centuries apart, spooky prognostications, trees withering at Jesus' simple command, sun darkening in the middle of the day, a temple curtain miraculously tearing itself in half. In seeking to find the real historical person behind these narratives, we are using these texts as sources for a figure that they themselves show no interest in at all. Just as the myths and legends about Hercules are simply not about a historical person, so the Gospels are not about the historical Jesus, unquote. Were such supernatural elements present in such quantities in Urwa's seerah as they are in the canonical Gospels, no reasonably skeptical scholar of Islam would likely be looking there for kernels of history. Ibn Ishaq's later seerah certainly has its share of miracles and fantastic elements, and Urwa's earlier reconstructed text is not devoid of them. But that is not my main point. Both, like the Gospel, are theological texts. Thus, what we have is not necessarily history, but sacred history, a history that is retold with the aim of instilling religious faith and may or may not be founded on fact. Even non-skeptical scholars of the historical Muhammad, like F.E. Peters from NYU, are cautious. He concludes that the historians of Muhammad must rely on sources that were recorded long after the memory of the events had faded, which were, and I quote, embroidered rather than remembered. The study of Islamic origins, or the historical Muhammad, if based on Gürke or Schuller's reconstructed Ur text, or Motzke's Ur hadiths, I don't think he's ever used that word, but I'll use it, is forced to rely on material that was produced with a thoroughly theological perspective. Scholars who read history, read it as history, are thus reproducing in a scholarly voice the basic theological claims of the Muslim tradition's presentation of its own origins. At the very minimum, the theological agenda witnessed by the supernaturalism of so many events in the seerah, as with the Gospels, demands that the burden of proof be transferred to these texts. In other words, scholars cannot begin with the assumption that the text must contain some historical facts and that the skeptic needs to prove that the event or saying is not historical before treating it as such. Rather, scholars must begin with the assumption that the texts do not contain any historical facts. Outside corroborating facts are needed before any event or saying is deemed historical. And as I have suggested, the Quran and the Sunnah cannot serve as those outside sources. Now, I'd love to turn to archaeology here, but of course, there's almost no archaeology going on in Mecca or Medina. Does that mean that the texts, whether Sirah, Sunnah, Quran, Gospels, Torah, are not of use for historical research? Not at all. The Adam and Eve creation story is an extremely valuable historical text, just not for reconstructing the historical Adam. No matter how complex the criteria of authenticity, if you find some sort of methodology to do that, no matter how thorough the reconstruction of the social, economic, political, or cultural life of the ancient Near East, we would never be able to establish a single historical fact about this first Christian son of God, as Adam is called in Luke 3:38, or the first Muslim prophet and caliph, as he is called in the Quran. I am more confident about finding a historical Muhammad than a historical Jesus, and a historical Jesus than finding a historical Adam, but all three are the product of sacred history. They differ in degree, not in kind. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Berg. Okay, what I think we'll do is we'll maybe have a briefer little roundtable discussion than we originally imagined, just because we're a little more short on time than we thought we might be. So maybe for a few minutes, we can have you guys dialogue amongst each other, and then we'll open up the floor for Q&A. Bob, do you potentially want to get things started?
I noticed you said that the minimalists didn't really deal with archaeological evidence. It was my impression that Thomas L. Thompson, for instance, wrote this giant cinder block, The Archaeology of Palestine, or some long title, that his whole thing was based on archaeology. You're just saying it was out of date?
Partially out of date because it wasn't his fault. A lot wasn't, that we have now wasn't in his knowledge. He didn't know about it. Mm-hmm. But a lot of that, it was based on Finkelstein. He became, mm-hmm. Finkelstein didn't jump into the minimalist camp. I think they adopted him as their archaeologist, mm-hmm. because they weren't doing the excavations he was. Mm-hmm. It's very interesting, though, to note, who I'm more familiar with is Finkelstein, and he was actually, you would have to say by all standards, sort of a maximalist until about 1990. Mm-hmm. Even as late as 1989, he wrote a text that, he wrote an article that said, we have a lot of factual information here that corroborates some of the stories in the Bible, especially about the formation of the Israelites, what I showed in Iron Age 1 and all of that sort of thing. And also he was very complimentary about David. Mm-hmm. So it is interesting that shortly after that he started to down-date. And I think part of that is, just logistically, he was working in the north of Israel, in the northern kingdom. And there's this competition, just I didn't throw it out there, but there's this great competition between Jerusalem and Tel Aviv universities, very much so. They're 35 miles apart, but light years apart when it comes to interpretations. So there's a minimalist school, if you will, over there, Tel Aviv, and Jerusalem is a little bit more favorable. There is a moderate way to look at these things, and I think there are some really positive ways to look at this thing, you know, in the middle, you know, that there is some truth. But the more, like I said, the more we excavate, the more we know. So I have a question for you, if you don't mind. You're talking about the matins, the transmission of the attributions, you know, back in time, yes, to the original source. It ringed a bit like Talmudic conversations, where rabbis there are, in a sense, timeless. They're a rabbi from the 4th century is talking to the one from the 2nd century, and they're all in the same conversation. If you didn't know better, you realize these guys never knew each other and had no hope of knowing each other, but they're having a conversation across time. So time is different handled there. What Judaism doesn't tend to do, though, is to say, okay, Akiva is the first one who said this, therefore the tradition is from the 2nd century or something like this. Could it be with the matins, the way they were transmitted, and I'm ignorant of this, but could it be that someone in a later time is attributing someone older just to make it more authentic?
Yeah, that's more or less how the, that's the Schacht, what Schacht is implying, is that these texts, somebody insists that they have come in this form, and therefore everybody scrambles around and finds these somewhat an earlier authority to say they said this, and that's why we're treating it as law. But when there's competition, we'll say, but we've got it earlier. Then they go one step further, and soon it's everybody is in Muhammad. Now, so I don't get in too much trouble, I'll give an example, a very obvious example. If you look at, I do mostly commentary on the Quran, and look at a figure called Ibn Abbas, who's a sort of famous commentator on the Quran. And if you look at At-Tabari's collection of him, he always says, and the the exegetes disagree on this and on the interpretation. And then he'll group them together, those who agree. You see Ibn Abbas in four having four different opinions, right? Clearly, he, you know, if he did these things or said these things, he wouldn't be that confused. Or some people said, oh, maybe they've misremembered things and this is a product of oral written transmission. But sometimes they are so different, it seems very problematic. Mm. So, of course, one of the things I argue is that, in fact, Ibn Abbas became this figure within Quranic commentary, at least for Sunnis, as the ultimate authority. And so you can, I think they projected back on him. And when it comes to legal hadith, it's projected back to Muhammad as the ultimate authority. So they are trying to do that. Does that go on forever?
I think just one, I have one question for you, but I should put it out there. I think I'm the only one here who says, David, my figure actually existed historically. And I think we can actually show it from the text and archaeology, in this case with David. Anyway, but I have a question for you, Dr. Price. So I'm a little surprised to hear that Jesus might be a myth myself. What do you do with the earliest graffiti of pilgrims coming to Jerusalem and writing, Lord, we are here, in the late first century? I know there are problems with pilgrim records, but there's brand new evidence coming out of the Holy Sepulchre right now, actually it was just released, that the Holy Sepulchre in Jerusalem, the purported tomb of Jesus, has actually now been renovated, and they've gotten down to the original business of the tomb and the first dated it to the first century. What do you do with all these other traditions that come in? What are these people talking about if they're not talking about Jesus?
Well, I assume they are, but the notion of saying there's too narrow a gap between Jesus and these various developments is, I think, circular, because if the gospel Jesus or even the Pauline Jesus is just the final outcome of a process of mythic evolution stretching back to inside and outside Israel with dying and rising gods and so on, the bottom drops out of it chronologically. And you have to then ask, when was Jesus likely historicized? And it seems to me that that would be in the late first century, perhaps, because of the institutional needs of the Catholic Church during the period where Gnostics, Ebionites, and all manner of other ones had competing claims, many of them based on claims that God or Christ has revealed something to them, and the historicization would be a way to meet that by saying, you guys go ahead and have all the hallucinations you want. We got our material from the horse's mouth. He existed, he started our institution, and the people who trained us were trained by his students, and so that's that. Irenaeus argues this way against Gnostics. The pseudo-Clementines have Peter trying to refute Simon Magus on this exact basis, and my guess is that it was church politics that led to the need for a historical founder, so they could claim the copyright on it, and that might be the date to look for. But if there was, like, I know there's something in early inscription in Jerusalem where in a tomb it says, Jesus, let him rise, and another one was similar. Well, that's compatible with either a mythic celestial Jesus or a guy they remembered from the past. You'd need more to be sure, what do they mean, the Jesus in the Gospels and the Easter time movies and all of that, or do they mean the God Jesus?
Mm. May I also comment on that? I don't think most of you probably know, I actually work in two fields. Well, the other one is the Nation of Islam, which is interesting because it started in Detroit. And I got interested in it because of the origins question, right? And I have no doubt there is a historical Wallace D. Muhammad, or whatever his name might have originally been, and that he was active between 1930 and 1934. But by 1936, after he has disappeared, he comes to be seen as God, right? Elijah Muhammad calls him Allah. It's in writing, you have witnesses, right? They're living. We have this. We have their recordings, their actual words written down by FBI agents in files, right? So one of the unique origin things, this is why I got interested in, as you can see. So the time thing makes a difference, right? This is why I think the claims that people make, we have to be, you can have people believe all sorts of things very soon thereafter. And one example I've at least used in class is, imagine if all the historical records of Pocahontas disappeared and all you had is the movie, right?
Or Elizabeth Warren.
Yeah, and you were trying to recreate who the historical Pocahontas was. And you might be able to say, well, there probably was one, but the historical details wouldn't be there. And it would be hard to reconstruct, say, what can we, well, not that you can't, wouldn't say, oh, she didn't exist. And I would never say Muhammad didn't exist or Jesus didn't exist. I'm just saying, I'm not sure what we can know.
Okay.
Right? That's what I'm sure. Now, I don't have archaeology like you do.
We know everything.
We have documents like the Constitution of Medina, but it doesn't have Muhammad's signature on it. We have lots of things, but they're all from the inside produced by sort of similar things. So in Islam, it's different. If I found one archaeological piece that would be definite, I would change my mind. Right? Because if it pushed it in another direction.
Okay.
That we don't have. So at this point, I'm just simply saying, based on what we see, I prefer to remain skeptical, but not saying it isn't so yet, unless we find evidence that somehow says, no, that isn't the case. Okay. Although I think in the late 70s and 80s, people were suggesting that a little bit with Muhammad, and I think with Jesus as well, that he, and I say, I just really don't know.
I'm curious, how did you become so interested in Islam, and have you ever been tempted to convert to it?
I get asked that a lot, especially when I say, no, I have read the Quran in Arabic, but I don't mind telling you, I was raised as a Christian, a Mennonite to be, and I was curious about other religions, and I started saying, why are all these Muslims wrong about their beliefs? And so I started studying religion. And the same thing about Buddhists and Hindus and things like that. So I started studying religion. And when, at one point I said, they can't possibly be wrong. Most of the Muslims I've met are actually far more pious and religious than I am. Perhaps they are all true. And so, but that forces me to ask the question, how can they, you know, if they're all but my religion, and I'm no longer religious, so, but if they're all wrong, how can they be wrong? That makes it an interesting question. Or if they're all right, how can they all be right and yet be different? So I happen to just be interested in Islam because it was different. And I had to pick one, actually, to get a job. So I thought there'd be a job at the end of Islam because I thought it would still be in the news. This was back in the early 80s. I got right.
Yeah.
When the way that Buddhists... You know, they're only coming into their own now in Myanmar and place like that. But yeah, and so it was really something that simple. It just sort of fascinated me in these questions of how do we know what's true. So I got fascinated about origins. And this is the same reason I got interested in the Nation of Islam. I'm not interested in as a social movement. I'm interested in how do you go from what we know from police reports and sociologists reporting in 1934 to a movement that produced Malcolm X, Louis Farrakhan, and now who has moved into Dianetics. Mm-hmm. Louis Farrakhan. They're doing auditing now.
You mean he's switched to Scientology?
No, he's incorporated their methodology.
Oh, I see.
It just gets more and more interesting.
Okay, there are questions from the audience? Yes, please, David.
Yeah, a question mostly for Bob, but maybe the other two as well. I guess from my knowledge, it's almost certain that there was no historical Jesus. And the reason is you have no corroborating evidence, either archaeological or documentary or anything. The earliest corroborating evidence is Josephus in the year 93. So I guess what we have is the letters from Paul, which date from 50 to 70, and then we have the Gospels, of which I assume probably would date between 70s and 90s, the traditional dating of those documents. And so it seems clear that those guys are assuming that there was a historical Jesus, but there seems to be clear that there was not. So from my perspective, those guys were basically liars, if I can put it bluntly. They were flat out lying. So the question was, why were they lying? Was it just for the, you know, the glory of building a church and they wanted to put themselves in front of the church, or was there another motive why those guys were lying in the letters of Paul and in the Gospels?
Well, I tend to date the Gospels in the second century, and in the The Pauline epistles, I think, are one and all spurious, just like every document attributed to Peter is considered to be spurious by critical scholars. But they hang on for dear life to the lucky seven out of the 13 Pauline epistles when the same criteria convinced the Dutch radical critics of the 19th century that all of them were spurious. And I find them much more understandable that way. So though it could all be early and still the product of just rumor and legend and the adaptation of previous myths. Like, I think that there's some reason to think that Yahweh was supposed to be a dying and rising god like Marduk and others, and that this percolates down to the death and resurrection of Jesus, and that there's so many likely tributaries into Christian mythology that I don't see the need to say that they were lying, though you can find individual instances like Second Peter is basically a pack of lies. You know, we weren't devising myths when we told you about the power and coming of our Lord. We were there on the Holy Mount. No, you weren't. And you claim to be Simon. Get out of here. You can easily tell. But I wouldn't assume that it's all lies. Some of it is. Like the empty tomb story. The first time we hear it, we're told that the women who discovered the tomb were told to go tell the disciples Jesus rose, but they didn't. And that's where the gospel ends. Well, somebody's going to say, well, wait a minute. How did you know that they saw this if they told no one? and there's other things like that where I think somebody is engaging in pious fraud. But on the whole, I just assume people assimilated stories from Apollonius and Pythagoras and Elijah and Elisha, because there's certainly striking similarities, and that the whole thing was just woven like the stories of Krishna or Mithras, that nobody thinks there was a historical Krishna or Mithras. I think the same is true with the Buddha, that or Moses, certainly, it wasn't deceit so much as just received tradition that had bubbled and morphed over centuries to evolving almost literally the same kind of thing. And the historical Jesus is sort of like when mutations accumulated that this critter is no longer a flying reptile, it's a bird. And you draw these lines somewhat arbitrarily. I think you can show Jesus evolved from Osiris and others, and very likely. I mean, you'd have to have a time machine to be sure. Ultimately, you have to be agnostic, but that seems much more plausible to me than taking the gospel stories as having even a historical core, because nobody's ever been able to find it. I was just debating Bart Ehrman, and I said that the one big problem I have with his argument is that there could have been a historical Jesus who, however, was not yet believed to do all these miracles and so on. He was just a prophetic preacher. And I said, in other words, you can tell I'm a comic book fan, you're saying there was a historical Superman, but he was just Clark Kent. Who would have made a religion based on Clark? So the whole thing is self-defeating.
Yeah, and the Islamic version of what people say when they're arguing against it, say, oh, well, there must have been a conspiracy to make this all happen. I don't know if you need lies or conspiracies. It's simply if you believe it to be true. I mean, I think they might have been actually believed it happened this way. Now, the real question is why would they believe this sort of thing? And that's an interesting historical question, but that's now we get into sociology, anthropology, and lots of other disciplines within the humanities to start looking at that particular question. And I think we're all familiar with that people can have things they really believe to be true or their own narratives, and we sort of scratch our heads from the outside, how could that be? And of course, the other, I think, interesting question is once they wrote it, why did people believe it, right? It's not just a question, even if they did lie, the interesting question is what are these socioeconomic, political, whatever, psychological things that someone says, that's the one I'm going to pick? Because there are certainly lots of competing stories out there. So something's going on that makes it both believable to the people, I think, who are writing it, but even more so to the people who are reading it and saying, ah, yes, this is going to be an important text. All these others, ugh, who cares?
There's a talk of the prophets in like a religious context or historical context. My question would be, if you're an Arabian in 9th century Arabia or Hebrew in 2nd century Jerusalem, would you understand to take these texts with a grain of salt, or would you have a literal interpretation? Because I would think, if I'm seeing that the Quran was written down, you know, 100 years ago, or people are cobbling together hadiths, I would perhaps take it with a grain of salt or allegorically, or if I was a Christian the same way, versus, you know, 1,000 years later, people say, well, this is how it's been written down. So my question would be, to summarize it, do we know if a literalist view was common or an allegorical view of the religious text or the hadith or whatever applies?
That is a great question, and I find it impossible to figure out how that is. John Dominic Crossan says that the people in the first century didn't believe all these miracle stories, and we're stupid to think they did, but I'm afraid I don't see why he thinks that. Cadbury wrote a book, The Peril of Modernizing Jesus. I think Crossan is modernizing the early Christians. There's no reason to believe they would have seen any problem with this. I mean, look at all the other stuff people believed back then. But you never know, because allegorical interpretation does go way back. Barbara Thiering said that we know that early Jews and Christians approached their own scripture, at least some of them that way, if they were writing new scriptures, maybe they would write it with that understanding. So I'd love to know if anybody can figure out how you would determine it.
And as for the case with Islam, there's a famous hadith about the formation of hadith. And it says something like, isnads were demanded after the fitna. And the fitna is the civil strife. So the question is when did the civil strife? Is this the battle between Ali and Muawiyah? Is this is it earlier than that? Is it later than that? Is it the Abbasid Umayyad one and or the the Zubayrids against the Umayyads? And so you would say, once we know that date, we know when it started, and we can make a better guess at it. I hear the story a little bit differently. I hear, clearly the fact that someone was demanding isnads for these reports that were going back means somebody was inventing them, right? So this goes all the way back to the beginning. If you want to start it earlier, you're actually making the case that you have companions and successors starting to make up stories about Muhammad and applying isnads to them. Now, like I said, I think these people truly believe that. So when you're talking about legal schools inventing this stuff, you said people just making things up, and I'm sure the people in the legal school says, well, this is what we've always done. This has been our practice. Our practice goes back, you know, through our founding fathers, let's say, and let's say to someone like Malik ibn Anas, so the Maliki school. And of course, he would have gotten it from Medina, which would have gotten it from Muhammad. So at most, they're inventing an isnad, but even so, they could say, no, this is probably how it came back. So I don't think they're necessarily thinking they are fabricating, because every time I've used that word, man, have I gotten in trouble. And I say, no, you don't have, it doesn't have to be fabrication, even though it may be not authentic, right? Just because, again, they believe it would have gone back to Muhammad. And it's and I like the term used, pious invention might have been a good way. So nobody was thinking they were doing something, you know, I'm sure there were cases where somebody said, okay, well, we're learning from the same teacher. I don't want to, and you told me this thing, I'm just going to go straight to my teacher. I'm going to invent and skip you in the isnad. I'm sure people did that. That's a very human thing to do, and we can actually see that sometimes. So there's clearly sometimes fabrication, and people, but that's what they were looking for. And certainly they caught it sometimes. But the massive, again, I would like to, like most people, I think they truly believed what they were doing.
Well, look at the genealogies of Jesus in Matthew and Luke, which cannot be reconciled. Were the people that wrote those down just making it up? They were and they weren't, because they must have started with the assumption, well, we know the Messiah is descended from David. We know Jesus is the Messiah. What's the most likely way to connect the dots? I'm sure modern genealogists do something similar when they say, well, I've got a good bit of scraps for your lineage, but some of these links are going to be hypothetical. Or a better example would be the fulfilled prophecies in Matthew. You get the impression, well, even in 1 Corinthians 15, Jesus died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures and rose on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. Were they looking for proof texts to justify events people remembered, or were they positing the events based on a kind of esoteric interpretation of the prophecies? And I kind of think the latter. How did Matthew know that the Holy Family went to Egypt? Well, because he noticed the word, the phrase, my son in Hosea 11:1, out of Egypt I have called my son. What's that? Oh, must be a secret prediction of Jesus. So they went to Egypt and came back. And I think you can show that in virtually the case of virtually every story in the Gospels. It looks so much like they were based on Old Testament texts. And my guess is they were. Were they making it up and lying? No, they were interpreting scripture. They thought, I think I can discern the hidden meaning. This really tells us about what Jesus did if we know how to read it. So it was in good faith, though it's not what we would consider historical source material.
Yeah, Aaron? How do you draw the line comparing all of these different forms of some of these documents when you have things that have gone through so many translations and revisions? How do you couple that with what you can get that is your raw historical data? Because just because you have a date that could say, yes, I see that this can line up historically with roughly the same time that it's stated, when you have so many different accounts of those events, despite them happening around that same time, how do you know that you can really confirm one thing and deny another based off of that when you have things that can't necessarily be represented in a straightforward data or hard evidence piece of archaeological?
Well, I think the problem and their elaborate criteria of dissimilarity and of embarrassment and all this, where they try to sift out what Jesus really did and said, I think it's completely self-defeating. And the big problem is, with these criteria, you can rule out an awful lot of stuff, but what's left may be just as spurious. There's just no way to know one way or the other. Like, it's pretty obvious that Jesus couldn't have said to the crowds, obviously during his public ministry, whoever would be my disciple, let him take up his cross and follow me. Now, that's spoken to the reader over the heads of the characters because it assumes you know Jesus went the way of the cross, which nobody in the scene would know. Is he going to say this? Well, what the heck? What's he talking about? And so that, okay, that's anachronistic. I can rule that out. But then if you have another one, or like Jesus is given four different opinions on fasting between Mark, Matthew, and the Gospel of Thomas, did he say all of them? Not unless it was a multiple personality. Did he say any of them? There's no way to know. So ultimately, I think there's just skepticism. Plus, there's the possibility that the Quran is a collection of earlier hadith. I mean, if they were orally transmitted, that's a red light going off in my head. Who knows if those who transmitted them fabricated them like they did the ones we recognize as hadith. I don't think there's any way to know. And so then if you have a faith that depends on allegedly knowing, I think you're barking up the wrong tree. There must be, but these texts are not like nothing. I mean, they're filled with riches. And so there must be some alternate approach, I think.
Yeah, I'm not quite as skeptical, but because sometimes you can find something. It's like the first time something appears, give a sort of modern example. If I told you that in my youth, when I was your age, I took out my iPhone and made a selfie, right? There you go. There's no way that happened, right? And in Islam too, I mean, when you're talking about translation, you don't have to. You can study Arabic. And although classical Arabic is not like modern standard Arabic, it is readable. In fact, I prefer classical Arabic over modern standard Arabic. At least it's more readable to me. So you can actually go in language. Now, I can't be sure what a word might mean. What does it really mean when it uses this word? Because then I'd have to study the context, like a bunch of other texts. So this sort of comparison, you can get some facts just from texts. this word never appeared. In these earlier ones, suddenly it appears. I think that's something in the archaeology. It's sort of an archaeology of text, right?
Right.
You were talking about structures. Now it suddenly appears, and now it's everywhere afterwards.
Right.
You can do some of that in text, but it doesn't give you those definitive answers. Now I'm absolutely sure, or this is the whole, I will hinge my whole argument on this one little fact. Although scholars do that. I tend to say, boy, if you're going to build a whole edifice about how Islam emerged based on one word like fitna and when it happened, you just need one good grad student to come up with another brilliant idea and suddenly all your life's work is gone and it'll happen.
True.
That's what you should all do. Destroy
yeah.
everything I've said.
Okay, we have time for just a couple more questions. Yeah.
Dr. Berg, I was wondering, and not sure, Luxembourg,
yes,
where do you stand on his view that the Quran has its origin in Syriac, Syriac Christianity, and I believe he also extends that into Muhammad is an evolution of the Paraclete.
Yes. This is why skeptics. This is why skeptics don't call me a true skeptic, because I'm skeptical about him, and there's reasons why. Just very briefly, his method involves looking for words that don't make sense, that the exegetes themselves don't understand, even a few, what seems to be a few decades, centuries later. So there's a problem. So he first looks for a Syriac root for that. And if he does, he tries to see if that makes more sense. If that doesn't work, he sometimes takes away the dots and the vowels, because the original Arabic was out there. And then he looks to see if there's a Syriac root that makes sense. So my problem with that methodology is that he will find it eventually, right? Because it sometimes even swaps around letters. And once you get going that far, mm-hmm. it seems that you are assuming what you are trying to prove. Mm-hmm. Now, that doesn't mean it's not true, right? That root isn't there. But the methodology is a little bit problematic. His group, Inara, the people who, they want to put the Quran, almost in Abbasid times. But we now have fragments with carbon dating that make it a little bit earlier. In fact, one of the carbon dating makes the earlier date puts the Quran before Muhammad, which would be very problematic if that was the case.
That makes sense,
yeah,
too.
You don't want to be fighting that used carbon dating too strictly, because somebody's going to say, well, let's use the earlier date as opposed to the later date, because it's always a range. It's still possible that there's a Syriac origin for these things. I mean, the word Quran itself seems to be, I think it's Keriana in Syriac, which means something like a liturgical text that is recited. It seems to be one of those foreign vocabulary of the Quran. If that's the case, it's plausible, but I don't think he has proven it. He has just raised a lot of doubts that we need to look in great detail.
That actually is more, is he completely off his rocker, or does he have a potentially legitimate point? That's kind of where I was getting.
I don't even want to say it's legitimate, because that means I would know more than I do know.
Okay.
I'm saying it's not outside the realm of possibility, and in 20 or 30 years, we might see, if somebody finds a Syriac text, even, three or four sentences that are identical to something, or the script would be close to something that is in the Quran, it's proven, or it's much more likely. But until we find something that we can be that certain of, it's a little bit problematic. And then when they want to date it, that all of Islam emerged in Abbasid times, that's hard. I mean, the Dome of the Rock's inscriptions do not agree with the Quran, but they're awfully close, right? clearly something that we can date, and also these new fragments something we can date seem to be earlier. So maybe, yes, if these texts are early, they did come, and for the people who aren't familiar, he's sort of suggesting that there was a Syriac community, perhaps in Arabia someplace, and when they got adopted by this new religious movement, and then they were written down in the defective script of Arabic without the dots and the vowels as the Quran was originally written down, and later on they had to make sense of it. And sometimes they guess wrong, so sometimes they were talking about virgins when in fact they were talking about grapes. And I'm not sure the word, that particular example, grapes, makes that much more sense in that story. So this is my problem. I mean, I've talked with him. I've been invited to that group to talk. I'm a little bit, I'm not, you have to be skeptical about the skeptical position as well if you're going to be true to your position, which is why, you see, I've been accused of being, not this terminology, a maximal, not a minimalist, but at the same time, oh, somewhere moderate in between. And I'm accused of being either one by the opposite side. And I think that's usually a good sign.
Yeah.
Best to be accused by being on the wrong side by both, because that means you're at least willing to entertain that you could be wrong.
Casey?
Yeah, my question's for Dr. Price. When in discussions concerning Jesus as a historical figure, eyewitness testimony is often cited, for example, Peter's writings concerning Jesus. I'm wondering if there's a scholarly criteria for determining the strength of supposed eyewitness testimony, or if they're not to be taken very seriously.
Well, Dennis Nine, one of the great form critics, pointed out decades ago that it doesn't sound like eyewitness recollections, like in the Acts of John, this second century apocryphal work. John, the disciple, is with a bunch of converts, and he's reminiscing about what it was like to be with Jesus. And he says, well, once Jesus said this to me, or once I reached out to touch him, and my hand went right through as if he were a spirit, and so on. Well, this can't be authentic, but at least that writer understood what eyewitness testimony would look like, whereas there's not even an attempt at that in any of the Gospels. Now, as people correctly point out, it could still be based on eyewitness testimony, because in transmission it would have gotten formalized and sort of whittled down for easy transmission. But the problem is, though it might be, you can't use any formal criteria to show it, because anything else passed down orally would sound the same. And the main reason they like to say it's based on eyewitnesses is just for apologetics, to try to say, see, you can really believe he did all this stuff. And they always go back to the quote of Papias, the bishop of Hierapolis, in the early to mid second century, who said that we don't have the book, but there are a number of quotes from him, and he says, I always made it a point to talk to any surviving people who had witnessed the disciples of Jesus, and I asked them what the disciples said Jesus said, and wrote it down. Well, he has, there are two substantial, well, if there's the one that that Mark was based on the oral preaching of Peter, and that Matthew was, it doesn't really say much about that except the wrong thing that was written in Hebrew originally. But the other two biggies, one of them is that, is an apocalyptic saying which looks so much like something from the Syriac apocalypse of Baruch, it looks like he's misattributing it. And the other one is a real whopper, because he says that Judas Iscariot, before he died by exploding like Mr. Creosote in Monty Python's Meaning of Life, he swelled up to the proportions of, we would say, of like a parade float, so that he couldn't squeeze in between buildings on either side of a street, and he was urinating live maggots and so on, and then finally, kaboom! It's obvious this guy had no sense of what was authentic tradition or not, and it amazes me people continue to appeal to this. So if he did even say this, there's just no reason to believe anything he said, and people quote this as if, like their habit of quoting a Bible verse and saying, okay, it's in the Bible, that settles it. They just say, well, Irenaeus or Papias said it, so that's true. There's no reason to doubt that. It's just all wish fulfillment. So no way of telling.
Okay, well, we're over time, so why don't we stop there? Let's thank our speakers for their tremendous... And thank you all for coming. This event has been filmed and will be available to watch on Netflix and everywhere else at some point in the near future. Thank you very much.